Bethel World Outreach Church. Reaching a city to touch the world.
Psalm 68, verse 6, and then we're going to spend all of our time in Ephesians 2, 11 through 22. The greatest news I have for you today is I won't preach long because I don't have long. And I know that was a relief to somebody in this room. So the Bible says, the t-shirt I have says get connected. The whole series we've been in, We Are Family, is about getting connected. And it is difficult. And the Bible says in Psalm 68, 8, that God puts the alone in a home, or he puts you in a family. He gets you connected. God wants you connected more than you might want to be connected. Now, living in isolation is a very easy thing to do right now. You can isolate from people at the same dinner table. You can be on the phone, they can be on the phone, and everybody can just be in their own world, but you're seemingly together. We have the illusion of togetherness without being together. And we know that the Bible says two is better than one, and we know that it's better to be together, but it's something about us that likes to look like we're connected but actually be disconnected, and I'm coming against that today. And there's three things you're going to see. That it's impossible to have unique defined and healthy human connection without a connection to Christ. You have to get connected to Christ. I'm not talking about where you say it. I'm talking about where it's evident in how you live and you walk and you think and you be. You're taking advantage of what Christ provides. Then if we are connected to Christ, wouldn't it show up in our community? Wouldn't this connection show up? Wouldn't this diversity, this connection with God and connection with one another, wouldn't this show up in some type of profound way? And then where do you get this message reintroduced and reaffirmed? And where do you become one with all of the other people who have this message? That's to get connected to the church. Christ is the beginning. The community is what you get to impact. But the church is what sustains the vision of you being connected. Now, here's the bottom line. I'm sorry for y'all that didn't know that your pastor used to be a gang member. But, you know, I know that shocked somebody. Was he? Was it the gangster disciples? No, it wasn't the disciples. You know, it just wasn't them. And the thing is, I've been in situations where if you've been in the middle of a gang fight, I have realized that I'm with the wrong people because we're losing. And I hate to be known as a turncoat, but I switched sides because I wanted to be on the winning side. See, when you don't have an authentic connection to things, if it's not based on the God and his values or things, you just go with the most convenient connection at the time. Whoever can help me out, because it's not about what Christ did for you and what you can do for others. Your connection is only to satisfy the longings of your heart as an individual. And that lacks purpose. Go to Ephesians 2, and we're going to see what we all should know, this connection to Christ and how important it is. Therefore, remember, that's what we're doing today. Remember that formerly you were Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who are called the circumcised, which is done in the body by human hands. Remember that it is at this time you were separated from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners of the covenant of promise, without hope, without God in the world. Verse 13, I love. But now in Christ Jesus, who once far away from has been brought near by the blood of Christ. You know, when you remember, that means you have to go back to the times when something wasn't right and figure out when it got right. I'm telling you things about my life that I don't want to say today. I remember being in the gospel choir in college, first year, and I would sing, and we would praise God, and we would leave the choir meeting. And we would go to people don't say club now, but yeah, the club, the party. And it was amazing that at one moment I was raising my hands and where, Lord, I lift my hands in worship. Lord, I lift. And I was like, oh, God. It's amazing how when I remember, I remember myself being connected with God's people. I remember myself being connected with whatever I wanted to do, how I wanted to do it, and thinking, I'm all right. But then a little girl in the gospel choir, she confronted me one day. She said, James Lowe. She said, you know God ain't in the club. I said, now listen, God know I'm a good person. I sing in the choir, I do the right things. God don't have a problem with people having fun. And I said, if you can show me in the Bible, show me in the Word of God where he has a problem with my fun I'm having, then I'll never go again. Well, she knew her Bible. She brought that word out. And she said, what fellowship had light with darkness? God don't want you in wild parties. I said, stop quoting all them scriptures. I got the point now. God don't want me in that. But the knowledge of the word and being in the gospel choir still did not produce change. I was connected to the answer, but I was disconnected from accepting it. And I'm going to tell you something. The more God gives you the answer and the more you actually reject the answer, you become more wicked. You become more vile. You get out of this category where you're moral and you start getting into immorality and vile living. And I got to the point where I still went to the party. And I was there, and now it wasn't a person or a little girl confronting me. I heard the voice of the Lord while I was dancing right there, while I was doing whatever I want to do. I was throwing it up high. I was laying it down low. I was doing everything. I said, God said, you better get out of here. Today, that's it. Get out. What you mean, Lord? He said, this party is going to be shot up. I'm done with you leading my people on. He said, it's over today. I remember God saying that, and I walked out depressed. I walked out of the party. I sat on the outside of it. Everybody's around me. I said, God said, if we don't get out of here, this going to be shot up. And I said, this is unbelievable. And so they said, well, let's leave. We left. The door slammed, and the whole thing got shot up. And I said, man, but you know what? It didn't make me serve God. God helped me escape. And then I stayed out all night. It's 3 a.m. And I saw, you know, when you're out at 3 a.m, you don't have good intentions. You know that, right? I mean, unless you're working a job, you're not thinking about Jesus. And I saw these skinheads. And I was pro-black. Let's just put it like that. Before God got in me, I was pro-black. And just the sight of them, and they was teasing this interracial couple, and I went over, I had somebody get me a bat. I've told this story many times, but it's relevant to this point. I had somebody get me a bat, and I waited until they got there, and I ran down that hill. And talking about after all the wooing of God, from the gospel choir, the girl, God speaking me to the party, saving my life. Now I'm still, and I think I'm on his side. I think I'm okay. And I ran down this hill. And if you get a weapon and you're running down, you have bad intention. My mind is not right. And I went down there, and I was running down there to hit them people. And I heard, woo, 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 woo. The police showed up just in time. Dropped the bat. They asked me what I was doing. I said, I don't know. I just want to go home now. All of that little, I know I'm a Christian because of what I do, went out the door. And now I'm turning to, I'm a Christian because of what he did. I want that. Because I had to say, Jesus, I can't get rid of anger. I can't get rid of lust. I can't get rid of confusion. Jesus, I have no meaning. I have no hope. I need my but God moment. Where are you right now? And all of a sudden, I can hear every voice that had ever preached the good news to me before. I hear every single voice. I hear them all, almost like a concert, pointing the way to Jesus is the only answer. And I have my but God moment where I believe that he's made the exchange, my life for his life. His blood has washed me clean, and I have nothing that I can point to that I was able to do on my own. But God stepped in, and he made the difference, and now I'm truly connected to Christ. I'm connected to Christ. But being connected, watch this, being connected to Christ does not mean that you're connected now to everybody else. Now when you get connected to Christ, you're going to have to encounter your community. And the proof is, if you're going to lead your community into the sin life you had before, or if you're going to lead them into the reconciled life Christ has for you. Look what he says in Ephesians 2, I think verse 14. For he himself is our peace. A lot of people are running around this world boasting about their ability to produce peace by their words, by their threats, by the fear that they promote. They think they can produce peace. You cannot have peace in this world without the Prince of Peace. Until Jesus Christ steps into the center of every circumstance, you'll still have one person on this side and another person on this side. And you know what it is? And everybody thinks they're right. He is our peace, who has made the two groups, which two groups? The Jews and the Gentiles, the arch enemies. One has destroyed, and he has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall, the hostility. Wait a minute. Everybody is telling you on TV that they're trying to take down the barrier. They're trying to take down the wall. They're trying to get rid of the hostility by being hostile. You push me again. I'm ready. You ready? I'm ready. You ready? I'm ready. What is this wall? Wall was not a physical wall. It's this invisible wall that we have all throughout our community that makes you be on the I'm on the man's side, I'm on the woman's side, I'm on the white side, I'm on the black side, I'm on this peep group side, I'm on that group side. I find my identity as a Jew. I find my identity as a Gentile. And I can tell you everything that's good about being me and everything that's off about being you. And when I have this mentality, I prove that Christ, I'm not connected to Christ. Because what Christ does is remove the wall. Remove what separates. He removes it. He says, by setting aside in his flesh the law with its commands and regulations, his purpose was creating himself a new humanity. A new humanity. His purpose was to create in himself a new humanity. He wasn't trying to create better Jews, better Gentiles, but better Christians in him. In him. You can't become better without being connected to him. Out of two, thus making peace. And in one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which he put to death their hostility. Wait a minute. All the violence that ever needs to be done was taken care of at the cross. I know as human beings, we think we got way more power than we have. We only have the power to talk about problems and create more problems. That's it.
Well, yeah, I'm going to tell you about those people.
You just talking. Jesus, through the work on the cross, is the one who solved the problem in the community. Community peace, community problems, disharmony among ethnic groups, it is not solved through a bunch of human thinking and talking about who's right and who's wrong. It is only solved by taking God and the good news about what he did on the cross and putting that as the centerpiece of the conversation, because it is the elimination of God that is creating the separation, because you can't do something to eliminate your dark heart without the God of the heart getting in there and changing it and washing it and fixing it. That's who you need, him. Are you divided today? Are you divided today? Well, maybe the question is, you never got connected to Christ. Because I'm telling you, you can actually be me in the choir, in the church, looking right, dressing right, actually being around all of the activities that Christians do, but yet in your heart is dark. And you are one incident away from being a part of the problem instead of the solution. You one Facebook post away. You just one click. You just see you doing that in, alone. I said, you need somebody to check every tweet before you tweet it out. Retweet, you need a checker. You need a checker. Baby, can you check this? Can you check to see if I'm speaking like Christ or like a Jew? Am I speaking more like a Gentile? Am I picking my side versus picking his will? What's my tweet about? What you posting? What are you posting? The problem or the solution? What is this? What is it? I don't even know. Some of us, just a quick little commercial. Some of us, the action step of the sermon is to delete your social media account because you're not accountable. You think there's a disconnect in the body of Christ. You think your words are not connected to other people. A team knows that what one person does on a team reflects on the whole team. Delete it. It's a gun that you don't know how to control. You got the safety off and you need it on. Delete it. Is social media making you closer to Christ? Are you searching for all of the Christian posts so you can build up your spiritual man? No. No, you're not. No, you're not. Don't even lie in church. No, you're not. You looking for everything that's corrupt? And then when you're a super saint, we don't look for deep corruption, just close to the line corruption where you can kind of feel what the corrupt people do without corrupting your own self. Stop playing the game. We're not connected. I got to go on to my last point because the clock tell me that. Verse 19. I know how to quote this. I love this. It said, consequently, we're no longer foreigners and aliens, but fellow citizens with God's people and members of God's household. Man, I like that. When you're connected with Christ, when you let Jesus Christ break down for you the community barriers that is separating you from people, when you no longer care about your identity independent of Christ, then you hang out in his church where you get reinforced that you are one people. You're in one house, serving one God, one mission, one purpose, and it is uninterrupted by human desires to preach another message. He says, members of God's house built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets and Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. If you don't understand a prophet and you don't understand apostle, it's okay. We'll teach you by and by. But understand that Jesus Christ is the foundation. No other foundation can a man lay than Jesus Christ. It is Jesus. It is Jesus. You want a solution? You need Jesus. You can call your mom. I called my almost hammers in 2 days. I didn't even plan to say this. I was in 2 days. I called my mama. I said, Mama, I was a freshman, redshirt freshman. And, you know, and somebody in the O-line, D-line drills kind of pushed me around and stomped me a little bit. And I kind of got sad and I didn't do it. She said, what you do? I said, I didn't do nothing. I didn't want to be fighting. He said, man, I'm going to tell you what you do. The next time you go out there, he said, the first play, you fight everybody. You fight everybody. See, there's a lot of voices out there to remind you what separation looks like. Very few voices, very few places on the planet are going to remind you what unity looks like. Last verse. And he said, in him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple. Wait a minute, in him, the church is not being about us. It's about him. We're connected to him. Everything we do is about him. And in him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God's spirit lives. I leave you with this thought. At the early church, when the Spirit of the Lord was first poured out, they asked the question of this diverse crowd, what do we do to be saved? He said, repent. Because this Lord you crucified, he's both Lord and Christ. Repent. They repented. They were baptized in water. They were baptized with the Spirit. And let me tell you the activities that they did. They continued every day in the temple at church. Every day they was in the house with each other. Every day they were eating together, fellowshipping together, preaching the word with each other, and praying together. They were together. One thing that makes teams great is the togetherness. Togetherness can overcome any deficit. Together. I beg you, church, be connected with Christ. Be a difference maker in how you connect in the community. And get connected in church as an opportunity, not a command. As a principle. As a guiding light and a guiding force to reinforce what you're doing.
If you've watched this message and you want to make Jesus Lord of your life, I've got good news. You can do it right now. I want you to pray with me. Say, Lord Jesus, come into my life for the rest of my life. I acknowledge I am a sinner. I need you, my Savior. I believe you died for me. I believe you were raised from the dead on the third day. And I confess that you are now Lord of my life. If you've just prayed that prayer, I have good news for you. You have eternal life. The next step for you is to get in a Bible-believing church. We volunteer to be that church. But if not us, we pray God's blessings on you as you search for God's best for you. Thank you.
Bethel World Outreach Church. Reaching a city to touch the world.